Welcome to Peer2Peer, the podcast, brought to you by Rayner. In this two-part series, Professor Graham Barrett takes the reins as host, stepping in for our fantastic regular host, Dr. Ben Larhood, to tackle an increasingly relevant topic, cataract and refractive surgery for patients who have undergone laser procedures. Keep listening as Professor Barrett is joined by respected guests, Professor Dan Reinstein and Mr. Darshak Patel from the leading London Vision Clinic, as they explore the intriguing world of aberrations and discuss why understanding these factors is essential for achieving optimal outcomes in this patient demographic.
Let's start off and let me say how delighted I am to be invited to host and talk about a fascinating topic which is more and more relevant, and that is how to manage patients who've had previous refractive surgery and now need lens extraction, either from cataract or clear lens extraction for refractive purposes. Let me introduce Dan and Darshak. Dan, you'll forgive me because I don't want to spend the whole session talking about your CV. It's vast and you're well known, so I'm going to assume that your fame has spread enough that people listening to the podcast will know you, who you are. And Darshak, you're one of the upcoming surgeons in the UK. Dan's explained how illustrious your track record is. And you join him in his clinic, and you are particularly responsible for some of the cataract surgery in these post-refractive patients. Dan, you are renowned for your work on presbyopes. This is one of the first applications of spherical aberration in refractive surgery. Some of the principles are very similar, in fact, to the RayOne IOL, but from the corneal surface rather than the lens surface. So traditionally, we were told that if you have myopic ablation, you have spherical aberration, positive spherical aberration, and you should choose your lens based on that principle. So without much thought, put in a negative aspheric lens, minus 0.2 roughly, and that would be suitable if you had a patient who had hyperopic LASIK or PRK, or SMILE for that matter. You should use a negative spherical aberration lens. I soon learned that you didn't have to obey those rules. But now we're using larger amounts of spherical aberration. And we do have patients that we know have more spherical aberration from their refractive procedure. So Dan, a simple situation would be to say if they've had any laser correction, don't use any EDOF, don't use any multifocal lens. And then perhaps you could use monovision, but you're limited. You limit the patient's prospects for unaided near vision. So what's your thought on that?
So when we're talking about spherical aberration that's helpful, we just need to go back to the 1990s when I was putting in SA60s and patients could read when they were plano after cataract surgery. And it used to be called pseudo accommodation because that was, at least it gave it a name. It sounded like we know what we were talking about. But what we didn't know was that the retinal image, which had spherically aberrated, it was a spherically aberrated image, was being filtered. And somehow the image of in the mind, and therefore the contrast, if we was going to talk about how to measure the image in the mind, was actually good. And this ties in to understanding why LASIK and PRK even took off in the first place. Because if you go by what some of the optical scientists were presenting to us, which was you can't have spherical aberration eye, it's a disaster, then we couldn't have done any corneal refractive surgery because you always increase the spherical aberration with surgery on the cornea, flattening the center. What we learned the hard way is that only about 30% of people had moderate to severe halos. Only. I did a survey when we did 100,000 eyes at LASIK vision in the late 90s. In 1 year, and we did an actual survey, and we were shocked at the percentage of patients that reported moderate to severe. And so It was like, wow. And they still want the surgery. They're still happy. They still have 95% satisfaction. Holy moly. But of course, it was because a lot of that is filtered. And now modern lasers, which cut more tissue in the periphery to reduce the induction of spherical aberration, are what they're doing is they're putting that spherical aberration into the therapeutic range, as we call it. So they are totally filtering and their contrast is normal. And so your principle, the first to come up with, well, first of all, you never deviated from anosmotropia is not a bad thing. Don't be afraid of anosmotropia. Anosmotropia is natural. Interocular rivalry is natural. It happens all the time. A tree is here and you can still see that there's a tiger over there, so you can run away. You don't just see a tree and then you get eaten by the tiger. So we've got natural alternate suppression, if you like. What you taught very well was that, you can give a small anosmotropy to anybody without even testing them. You don't have to do a contact lens trial. And that, combined with the advantages from spherical aberration, is what Presbyon does. We have a smaller image anisometropia, which with the spherical aberration gives you full near. When it comes to cataract surgery after laser refractive surgery, I would say we're just trying to restore the situation again. So let's say someone has presbyon and they're 57 and they have no cataract and they come back at 79 with a cataract. Well, they had good vision at all distance before and they have them now the window's dirty. Okay, well, let's take the dirty window out and put a clean window in and just restore what they had before, which was a therapeutic range of spherical aberration, which was with a small anosmotropia, which was giving them continuous vision from near through to intermediate through to distance.
So Dan, let me ask you a question following that. If a patient's had presbyon and comes back for cataract surgery, what lens would you consider would be ideal in that context?
I'll let Darshak answer because he's doing this every day.
Darshak?
Yeah, so as we talked about earlier, we would look at the in sort of general terms, look at the corneal wavefront in the 6 millimeter zone, obviously considering pupil size, etc. But that's kind of the benchmark. And then depending on the degree of positive or spherical aberration, I mean, we may want to add to that or reduce it. But we're not trying to reach a situation where we're zeroing it, is the point. Because as we, for all the reasons we've spoken about already, we want a little bit of spherical aberration. And Dan's previous research suggests that somewhere between 0.3 and 0.6 is acceptable with a minimal drop of contrast. So if you want to increase spherical aberration, there are not that many spherical lenses in terms of options. There used to be, as Zeiss is positive, yeah. The EMV basically is one of the few choices that you have if you want to increase it. So let's say somebody's 0.2 plus 0.2, you could add the EMV in. It might increase to 0.35 or something like that in terms of the whole eye wavefront. And then if somebody has had a hyperopic treatment and they have a, so they've got a little bit of minus, but not much, maybe minus 0.1, then you might want to use something to increase the negative spherical aberration. So then there are lots of lenses that do that. They all increase spherical aberration in the negative direction. So the idea is that we're trying to improve what they already have if they have small amounts. Whereas if they have amounts that are already quite high, as we talked about earlier, very old treatments, small optical zones, et cetera, large treatments, then they have sufficient aberrations on the cornea, then we can use an aspheric lens. And I generally would use the Rayner, the RayOne aspheric lens, to maintain what they already have. And then they still get a good depth of field from that.
And Darshak, have you had practical experience on patients with presbyon having a RayOne EMV? Have you?
Yes. At least 50% of our cataracts are post-presbyon. So it's a significant bulk of what we do. If they're low myopic treatments in the past, then I'm quite comfortable putting in an EMV, even though they have positive spherical aberration already. I'm quite happy to be able to do that if it's a small previous myopic treatment. And remembering that presbyopia doesn't induce, as some people think, huge amounts of spherical aberration. The whole point is it's a controlled introduction, and the profile increases it by a certain amount, but maintains it at a small level, albeit a therapeutic level. So we don't have patients who come back and have 0.8 microns of spherical aberration. That doesn't generally happen, again, unless they're historical patients. But they're generally small amounts, so we can still work to increase or decrease decrease if it's too high. Yeah.
What about patients who haven't had presbyondas previous myopic ablation? Do you do the same thing? Measure the amount?
Yes.
At the 6 millimeter zone.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah. I don't, whether they've had, you know, ablation on a Schwind or a presbyond or whatever, you're looking at exactly the same thing. I don't think it matters what the actual profile we used was or the laser used was. It's the same principle. It's what are the aberrations, mm-hmm. and then also considering coma, which is something that if someone has significant coma, that's going to give them some depth of field as well. I'm still a little bit uneasy putting in EMV if somebody has, you know, 0.4 microns of coma or something like that. So that's another thing that you want to consider, that I consider. But certainly the spherical aberration is the main thing.
Great. What's the exact, is it possible to know the exact spherical aberration of the EMV?
Yes.
Obviously, it depends on the power of the lens, but I'm like for a 20 diopter lens.
So it doesn't depend on the power of the lens there.
Ah.
Minor spherical aberration is pretty much consistent throughout the range. There's a small shift when you get to a very low, like a 10 diopter versus a 30, but it's minimal.
Okay.
Tension is present the same amount.
Okay.
So that's why it's not like a spherical lens.
Right. No, I understand. Okay, good. So it's engineered in that way. And how much is it?
It's probably for a 3 millimeter pupil, it's modest, it's about 0.14. Even you get up to 4 millimeters, you're in the 0.2 range.
I do pupillometry, particularly after laser cases, because although we look at the 6 millimeter zone on the topography and aberrometry on that, if somebody has a mesopic or a scotopic pupil that's 3 or 4 millimeters, then that's less of a consideration, I would argue. So whereas if somebody has a 5 millimeter pupil size, you might want to look at the zone in that area. So it's important to know how much there is across a 6 millimeter zone, because that's traditionally how you'd compare different corneas. But obviously, I think you have to factor in the pupil size. That's important. So pupillometry is important in these cases.
Our lens is 6, but that last part of the optic is hardly functional. So when you look at reports and lab testing of IOLs with spherical aberration, 4 is about the most you'll see, because to talk about 6 on a 6 millimeter optic, which is usually not exactly centered, you struggle to get your patients post-op at 6, to get them to 6. You struggle. So we're coming from a very different, you know, benchmark.
Keep listening for part 2 as Professor Graham Barrett continues the conversation with Professor Dan Reinstein and Mr. Darshak Patel on how to choose the right IOL for post-laser patients and the benefits of RayOne EMV.